Wow, that was amazing. All of a sudden it got quiet. Something must be happening. I'm Bill Mayer, a longtime trustee of the Institute, former chair, and it's my pleasure to be here today and, of course, to thank Bonnie and Tom McCloskey for their generosity in having this. Thank you. I first met Bill Browder 21 years ago when he was a class of 2001 of Henry Crown Fellows, which is the oldest leadership program we have here at the Institute. And over the years, I've gotten to know him quite well and, of course, have an enormous amount of respect for him. As I think you all know, he started Hermitage Capital in the mid-90s, 96, and became the largest foreign investor in Russia until November of 2005, when he was refused entry back into Russia. And that started quite a journey for Bill and the people around him. In New York, during the book launch, Bill told me that the publication of Freezing Order had been moved up 2 or 3 months. And I said, well, why was that? And he said, well, for years I've been trying to tell people it's all about the money, and not many people paid attention, and now everybody wants to know where the money is. So we will find out soon. And Ray Suarez, our moderator today, is a very experienced radio podcast host, and he has a podcast series Going for Broke, won several national awards. So I welcome you to Aspen, Ray. I apologize for the rain, but it'll be gone probably in 15 minutes. Ray's been more than 40 years in the news and business. And so over the years, most of you probably run into him, and I think we're very fortunate to have him here to be our moderator. And so now I'm going to turn it over to you, Ray, and thank you very much both for doing this.
Thank you. Well, Bill, when this entire audience reads the book, which of course you know they will, they will see a picture of a guy who, in recent years, has had to look over his shoulder. Are you worried in 2022? Do you still have to worry? Do you always have to worry?
So, in 2012, the Magnitsky Act was passed. The Magnitsky Act is named after my lawyer, Sergei Magnitsky, who was murdered in Russian police custody for uncovering a massive government corruption scheme. And in response to that, I made it my mission to go after the people who killed him, and that resulted in something called the Magnitsky Act, which freezes the assets and bans the visas of the people who killed Sergei, the people who commit other gross human rights abuses in Russia and elsewhere in the world. And Putin, who's a man who has a lot of money and commits a lot of gross human rights abuses, felt really worried about it because he thought that that put his whole business empire at risk. And he's made it his mission both to repeal the Magnitsky Act and to try to destroy me. And in terms of trying to destroy me, they've made death threats. Actually, his protege, Dmitry Medvedev, when he was at the World Economic Forum in Davos shortly after the Magnitsky Act was passed, he was asked by a group of journalists, what do you have to say about the murder of Sergei Magnitsky? And he said, it's a shame that Sergei Magnitsky is dead and Bill Browder is still alive and running around. The general prosecutor of Russia publicly said, Bill Browder shouldn't sleep peacefully at night. And of course, at the Helsinki summit in 2018, Putin asked Trump to hand me over. And so it's definitely a scary business to be on the, and why so Putin hates my guts. I'm at the top of his mind. I used to call myself Putin's number one enemy, and I think I can't say that anymore because Vladimir Zelensky is his number one enemy. And I think Alexei Navalny is his number two enemy, but I think I'm solidly in third place.
For people who don't remember when Vladimir Putin asked the President of the United States for Bill Browder and a list of other people, including the former ambassador to Moscow, Michael McFaul, you may remember that, what, he rejected it out of hand, right, and said, that's ridiculous, I could never do anything like that.
Well, actually, that's not exactly what happened.
You could have knocked me over with a feather, but tell people what happened.
Well, I mean, it was a remarkable moment. As everyone here remembers, there was a special prosecutor, Robert Mueller, whose job it was to investigate Russian collusion in U.S. political process. And Mueller had all sorts of different lines of investigation. And one of his lines of investigation, he discovered that there were 12 Russian military intelligence officers. They're called from the GRU. And these military intelligence officers had gotten involved in trying to influence the outcome of the U.S. election. And they were doing all these Facebook groups and paying people in Bitcoin and doing all this kind of stuff to try to tip the scales towards Trump. And these 12 GRU officers were indicted on a Friday afternoon in early July. And on the Monday, there was this summit between Trump and Putin. And so Trump and Putin go into this room, and nobody else was in the room with them. It was completely unusual, strange, no note takers, no secretaries of state, no nobody, just the two of them, plus, I guess, an assistant of Putin's. They spend 4 hours in this room, and then they come out of the room, and they go into a press conference. And it's kind of the obvious question. And so a Reuters journalist put his hand up and said to Putin, are you going to hand over the 12 GRU officers? And Putin looked like he had been preparing for this question all weekend, and he kind of smiled very self-confidently, and he said, well, it's possible that we will. But we would expect some reciprocity in this situation. And the reciprocity would be that we would like President Trump to hand over Bill Browder. And so then the next obvious question was, is Trump, what would Trump say about this? And so three questions later, a journalist raises his hand and said, Mr. President, what do you think about this idea of handing Bill Browder over? And he says, I think it's an incredible offer. And so I was waiting until after the whole thing was finished that one of his aides would then pull the press corps aside, and he said it was a mistake. He meant to say it was an incredibly bad offer, but it was silent. And so he goes home on Air Force One, and gets back to America. And I'm actually here in Aspen. I normally live in London, and I'm a British citizen, but I was here in Aspen at the time, and so in theory I could have been handed over. And so at that point, it was Bill Browder for the 12 GRU officers. But Putin was thinking to himself, wait a second, this is silly. I could get more than just Bill Browder. And so the next morning, they make a list of 11 other people they want. And one of them is former U.S. Ambassador Mike McFaul. They wanted a man named Kyle Parker, who was the chief of staff of the U.S. Helsinki Commission, who had literally written the Magnitsky Act. They wanted two former assistant secretaries of state who had worked with me on passing the Magnitsky Act, several currently employed investigators from the Department of Homeland Security that had been investigating crimes connected to the Magnitsky murder. And so now there was not just Bill Browder, the British citizen, but 11 American government officials or former government officials. And it was silent for the first day, silent for the second day, and then there was a press briefing with Sarah Huckabee Sanders, and the New York Times then said, is the president planning on handing over Bill Browder, Mike McFaul, and the 10 other Americans? And she had the, and that was the moment that she surely should have said, of course not, that's ridiculous. But she said, no, the president is considering the request and is consulting his advisors. And it wasn't until the next day when the Senate then decided to have a vote, should America not hand over all of us? And the vote was going to be unanimous that we shouldn't be handed over. And it was, and so the vote was coming in at 98-0. And an hour before the vote, Sarah Huckabee Sanders meekly said, "The president has considered the request and understood it was sincere, but has decided not to honor it at this time." And that wasn't handed over to the Russians. But it was quite extraordinary to think that I could be sitting here in Aspen, and then having a convoy of SUV, blacked out SUVs with Department of Homeland Security agents pack me off and put me on a plane to Moscow. That was really not a good moment.
Let's go back to the mid-90s. If in 1996, for instance, I had told you what Russia 2022 would look like, was that on your working menu of possibilities in 1996? Could you conceive of a klepto state, a brutal murderer of political opponents, the kind of place we see today?
So when I showed up in 1996, it was total chaos and criminal chaos. So they had basically dismantled the country in every possible way. And they hadn't really put in new systems. So they said, we're not going to be communist anymore. We're not going to be totalitarian. It's going to be every man for himself. And it was not pleasant by any stretch of the imagination. It was, people were being murdered left, right, and center all over the place. If you wore a fancy watch or, they would stop you and kill you. But it was disorganized crime, and when I showed up in 1996, so the answer is no. I could have never imagined it. What I was hoping for, my thinking, was that it couldn't stay this type of chaos forever. It would have to get, and I had a sort of term for it. I said this was the Nigeria to Brazil trade, that if you go from horrible to bad. Since I was a fund manager, you could make a lot of money. That was my thinking, and it did go from horrible to bad. It went from maybe horrible to very bad.
There are gradations.
and even when Putin first came to power, he was at first he wasn't this sort of unbelievable dictator that he is right now. And in fact, he was actually this insecure guy who didn't know where his power was and where it wasn't, and the thing about Vladimir Putin is that he has this amazing capacity to not show anything on his face. So he's just got this totally blank face, and so if you look at him, you could basically project onto him anything you thought or wished or wanted, and so I and most other people thought, well, okay, this guy, unlike his predecessor, is not drunk, he's not crazy, he's not. He's a boring technocrat, and that's how he presented himself, and for the first couple of years he actually was kind of a boring technocrat. He was doing economic reforms and he wasn't doing any of this crazy stuff, and there's an expression that power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And as he started to figure out how to get hold of the levers of power, then it started to get bad, and it got bad, and it got worse, and it got worse, and it got worse. But I actually could have never imagined that it would get to where it got today. I think this is something that even the most pessimistic Putin watchers couldn't have imagined.
Because these kinds of things, Russia's hardly the first country in the world to have a change to a brutal system. But in some places, it happens bit by bit, and in some places, it happens all at once. Hermitage was built on the idea that Russia was a place that was appropriate and promising for inward investment. It was, for a time, one of the top performing funds in the world. And I'm wondering whether you thought that's where the worm turned, where you thought, wait a minute, this is a lawless, feral state that's ready to kill anybody who's a problem.
Well, I'll tell you the moment that the worm turned. So when Putin first came to power, he wasn't really president of Russia. He was president of the presidential administration of Russia. Because all of the powers of the presidency had basically been stolen by the oligarchs. The oligarchs who preceded Putin had paid so much money to members of the parliament, they could get any law passed. They had employed members of the security services so they could get their enemies arrested. They could pretty much do anything they wanted to. And so Putin, in his first big his first big pitch to everybody in Russia was that we're going to get rid of the oligarchs and restore order in this country so these people don't control the country. And at first it seemed like a good thing because the oligarchs were indeed, you know, doing everything possible to make it an unpleasant place for the 145 million Russians to live. And so Putin arrested the first oligarch. It was a man named Mikhail Hordakovsky. He was the owner of an oil company called Yukos, richest guy in the country. And so I was pretty happy about that. I thought, okay, great, you know, one down, and there was 22 of these oligarchs, and they had stolen 40% of the country. And so I said, one down, 21 to go. And then the next oligarch was a guy named Roman Abramovich. I'm sure some of these people in Aspen here know that name, because he's got a place out in Snowmass. And so Roman Abramovich, okay, so we're waiting for him to be arrested and have his oil company taken away like Hordakovsky. But Putin didn't do that. Instead, so Hordakovsky had his oil company nationalized and he was sent to jail for 10 years. And Abramovich, they paid him $13 billion for his oil company and made him the governor of the Chukotka region. And I thought, wait a second, how is that getting rid of the oligarchs? And that was the moment that it really occurred to me that this Putin guy is not trying to reform Russia. He just wants to he effectively just wants to become an oligarch himself. And it's my belief that after the arrest of Hordakovsky, all the other oligarchs were so scared of him, they went to him and said, "What do we have to do so we don't end up like Hordakovsky?" And he said, "It's real simple, 50%." And I believe that in 2004, when after Hordakovsky was convicted and sentenced to 10 years in jail, that Putin became the richest man in the world by getting 50% of the assets of all the oligarchs.
It should be noted that both Abramovich and Hordakovsky are still alive, which makes them kind of different from some of these latest guys who've been having terrible, weird accidents. One Russian wrinkle to all of this, you know, states go bad, they rise, they fall. You describe chapter and verse in the book the capture of the apparatus of legitimate systems, often international ones, that are created to protect the rule of law. They're meant to be guardians of a rules-based system. But when the Russians pull on levers and cables, they in fact use them for the exact opposite ends. And that seems to be a particular talent of theirs in the current international system. They had European courts and Interpol and police stations and ministries of justice all wrapped around their finger looking for you.
Yeah, and so, well, let me tell you, so the book opens with a story, and I'm not going to ruin, it's not a spoiler, you'll still enjoy the book, part of my mission after the murder of my lawyer, Sergei Magnitsky, was to figure out who got the money that he had exposed that he was killed over. And we spent 10 years looking for the money, and that's a big part of what this book is about. And as we looked for the money, we started finding in all sorts of places. And one of the places we found the money was it went to purchase high-end luxury properties on the Spanish coast. And so we wrote, and every time we'd find where the money went, we would write a complaint to the law enforcement authorities of the country to have them freeze the money, which is why the book is called Freezing Order. And so we wrote a complaint to the chief anti-corruption prosecutor of Spain to freeze the money that we discovered in Spain. And he was intrigued, he was interested, and he invited me to Madrid to give formal testimony so he could open up a criminal investigation. So I arrive in Madrid, and as I'm walking out of my hotel room on the morning of my meeting with the prosecutor, there are two armed Spanish policemen standing out in my hotel room, and the hotel manager of the hotel. And the hotel manager says, "Mr. Browder, can you show these men your passport?" So I show them my passport, and they compare it with a piece of paper that they're holding, and one of them says, "You're under arrest." And I said, "What for?" "Interpol Russia." They take me down to the police car, and I had the foresight to tweet out that I was being arrested. And I get out to the police car, and I'm in the back of the police car, and I'm wondering to myself, maybe these guys aren't even police officers. I mean, you know, anyone could get a uniform, and maybe you could steal a police car. And I'm starting to panic, and when you're in the back of the police car, they don't have windows that open or the door. You can't just like jump out or anything. But they hadn't taken my phone away, and so I surreptitiously snapped a picture of them, the back of their heads with all the police paraphernalia, and tweeted that out just in case people didn't believe my first tweet. And then all of a sudden, like every journalist in the world started calling up Interpol headquarters and the Spanish police and the British government and everybody else. When I finally got to the police station, I think the Interpol had gotten 100 phone calls, and they realized what a complete mess that they waltzed into, and they released me and took me to my meeting with the prosecutor. And so, can you imagine how mad the prosecutor was? Because this is where it all kind of goes full circle. So, I had identified a bunch of corrupt officials in Russia who killed a man and who stole a huge amount of money, and then used it to buy property in Spain that were going to be investigated. And then the same individuals had used the law enforcement systems of Russia to then apply for an Interpol warrant that a different branch of Spanish law enforcement then to arrest me. So the same people that this guy, the prosecutor, wanted to investigate and prosecute were trying to have the chief witness arrested. I mean, and that is how everything has happened. The Russians have issued 8 Interpol arrest warrants for me. They have used every different international treaty. And that's what they do everywhere. I mean, they're at the United Nations now, you know, sort of vetoing every possible thing to get grain exported out of Ukraine so that there's not a world starvation crisis, et cetera. I mean, this is what the Russians do. They use all international norms, legitimate institutions, and they bastardize them. And it's not just the Russians.
But again and again, we see that the way these places are set up, the literal black and white agate type way these laws and institutions are set up, you can refute the truth with an enormous whopper. Bigger the whopper, the better. But if you do it with a straight face and a certain amount of vehemence and, incidentally, a lot of money, you can use the law to be a criminal. Were you hip to this until before you started living it?
No. I mean, I don't think anyone is. So I mean, it's remarkable when you think that the institution. So, I mean, starting with Interpol, but I'll get to a couple other examples. But the Interpol is the international police organization to catch fugitives. And Russia is using Interpol. Russia is a criminal organization using Interpol to chase the victims of their crime. That's just so wrong, it's unbelievable. But another example, and this is really interesting example, is that, so we, like this Spain story that I've just told you, we found money in the United States. We found a bunch of money from the crime that, the murder of my lawyer, Sergei Magnitsky, went to purchase high-end luxury real estate in Manhattan. And we then wrote a criminal complaint to the Department of Justice, and the Department of Justice froze the assets and then began a federal forfeiture process to seize the assets. And the complaint that they filed was so damning that I was certain that nobody would show up to defend it. And it wasn't against an individual, it was just to seize the assets. And but the Russians not only decided to defend it, they went and hired a lawyer. But of the 58,000 lawyers in New York City that they could have hired, they hired the lawyer who was my lawyer before, who helped me find the assets. I swear to God, this is true.
Now, this is one of the most outrageous, jaw-dropping stories in an already jaw-dropping book. John Moscow, and thank you for naming names all up and down through this book. There's an ecosystem of lawyers and law firms throughout the Western world that are ready to do this kind of bagman work for Russian entities. Your lawyer that you hired, who was recommended to you as one of the guys who knew this world inside and out, ends up working with all this prior knowledge, which should have disqualified him, ends up working for the Russians, but you can't get him taken off the case. That was astonishing and disturbing, frankly.
Yeah, it was terrible. It was unbelievable. So I hired this guy to help me find the money. What a name, John Moscow. I hired him to help me find the money, and he did some work for me to help me find the money. But while he was doing that work for me, he kept on telling me, this is really, really dangerous. You know, these are really bad people you're up against. They do terrible, terrible things. And he said, you know, I hope you or nobody else close to you is ever planning on visiting Russia again. I said, don't worry, we're not, because bad things are going to happen. These guys do terrible things. And then this guy turns up on the other side. And the first thing he does when he turns up on the other side is he issues a subpoena against me. And he wants all of my personal information, all of my security details, all of my travel records, all of that everything about me and everybody else around me, which will then go into the hands of the Russians, the same people he was telling me I should worry about killing me, because of course they wanted to kill me. And it was the most outrageous thing. And so we then immediately filed a disqualification motion. And so we filed this disqualification motion, and we got unbelievably unlucky. And we get this judge, his name was Judge Thomas Grisey, and he was 83 years old, and he had already lost. He was not fully fully with us, and we tried to explain to him that this was a lawyer who was breaking the rules because there was a conflict of interest, and the guy was he shouldn't have been on the bench because he didn't understand it, and so he allowed this lawyer John Moscow to proceed doing all this terrible stuff. And it took us like 3 years, and we had to go to the appeals court. And the minute they saw it, they said, this is unbelievably outrageous. They disqualified John Moscow and his law firm, and and Judge Grisey quietly retired. You think that all these systems work, and Interpol works, and the courts work, and all this. It's just shocking how, I kind of opened my eyes to the dysfunction of all these institutions that we think are there to kind of look after us and protect us.
But you did eventually get them taken off. But it was a closely played thing. It could have gone the other way.
Once we finally got it to the appeals court, it couldn't have gone the other way. But here's the interesting thing. So we get these guys kicked off the case, disqualified, and then they secretly continue to work for the Russians afterwards. Baker Hostetler. Let me just say that again, in case, because you're broadcasting. Baker Hostetler. It's a big law firm. If any of you work with them, you know, stop working with them. Baker Hostetler.
Why are you such a burr in their saddle? I understand why a guy like Vladimir Putin could be irritated by you. I entirely get it. And I get, unfortunately, why, tragically, Sergei Magnitsky was killed, and why other people who have been involved in this investigation were poisoned, had murder attempts made on them. But after a certain amount of time passes, and he eludes your grasp, You're busy wrecking your own economy by invading a neighboring country. You're jailing your domestic opponents, suppressing political parties. You're busy. Like, what is it that still has him trying you in absentia, layering on more charges and more years in jail when you return to Moscow? Why try Sergei Magnitsky, who's been dead for years, again, and bring up all kinds of new bogus information? If you're a dictator with the brio that's worth the name dictator, what do you even care about this penny ante stuff for?
So Russia is like one big prison yard. It's not a normal place, and everything is about power, subordination, respect. If you're the toughest guy in the prison yard and somebody disrespects you, you have to destroy them. Otherwise, people will think they can all disrespect you, and that's how Putin thinks. And by going after Putin, by going after his money, and by getting him and all of his people sanctioned, that is the biggest sign of disrespect there ever was. And he thought, if he doesn't show the world that something terrible should happen to Bill Browder, then he thinks that other people will do the same thing. And it's really interesting. I mean, so Putin has got this weird sort of mafia thing going where he never mentions the name of his enemies. And he's never mentioned the name Alexei Navalny, who's one of his big domestic enemies. He always says that lawyer, that person, that politician. But I pissed him off so much that he mentions my name constantly, and you should see it when he does. I mean, you can just see the emotion in his face. This is the one time when his face goes, you know, when that whole sort of blank poker face thing disappears, and it's really interesting and horrifying that he does that. But it's also kind of satisfying because I know that we've really hit the Achilles heel, that we've got him, that we've done something meaningful. I mean, a lot of governments and human rights organizations want to be seen to be doing something but don't actually want to do something. But we've actually done something. I mean, we've hit him in his Achilles heel. We've got him where it counts. And the fact that he's so angry with me shows that.
One person who emerges again and again. How many have seen the Woody Allen movie Zelig? Okay, well, Zelig is sort of this person who just keeps popping up. He's everywhere. The Zelig of your book is Natalia Veselnitskaya. If you follow the news, she also met with Jared Kushner and Donald Trump Jr., you may recall. They wanted to talk about adoption. do we know everything we need to know about Veselnitskaya's involvement in US affairs and the through line that gets her sitting behind Michael McFaul at a hearing, that gets her into the inner sanctum of the RNC, that gets her in all kinds of rarefied spaces that normally a Putin crony doesn't have entree to?
It's really, so Natalia Veselnitskaya is a Russian lawyer. She was the lawyer representing the people whose assets were frozen by the Department of Justice. But she went so far beyond that, it was not even funny. And as you mentioned, in 2017, the whole Mueller investigation was going full force. There was all this stuff about was there or was there not any Russian involvement with the Trump campaign? And then and I was actually on my way to Aspen for July of 2017, and I get a call from a New York Times reporter, and I was going from London to Aspen via Chicago, and I'm at the airport changing planes. And I've been trying to get everybody to write about, all the journalists to write about Natalia Veselnitskaya or her involvement in my case, because she was this very sort of dishonest, colorful character. And nobody seemed to be at all interested in her. And then I get this call from this New York Times reporter, and she says, "Do you know Natalia Veselnitskaya?" And I said, yeah, of course I do. And because like, here's this the first reporter actually interested. And so I gave her this full briefing at the airport. And I said, why are you interested? And she said, I can't really tell you, but just watch the New York Times. And a few hours later, when I land, there's a New York Times story saying that Natalia Veselnitskaya had been in Trump Tower on June 9th, 2016 to meet with Donald Trump Jr., Paul Manafort, and Jared Kushner. And she was there specifically this was after Trump had been nominated, but before he was elected, she was there specifically to ask for the Magnitsky Act to be repealed. And it's since been revealed that she wasn't just a lawyer working for a Russian oligarch, but she was effectively an agent of the Russian government. And this was a Russian, Kremlin operation. And if it's a Kremlin operation and they're going in to ask a possible future president of the United States to do something, they're not just going to do it without some quid pro quo. And so we knew what she was asking for. We don't know what she was offering. We think that she was offering dirt on Hillary Clinton, but nobody knows for sure what happened in that meeting. And she kept on showing up in other settings as well. She showed up at the U.S. Congress. She showed up with moving around with a Republican congressman from Orange County named Dana Rohrabacher. She was everywhere, and it's since been
Zelig.
It's since been revealed that she is, she was, a formal member of the, Russian security service. She was an agent of the Russian government.
The country where you were born and grew up, the country that you are now a citizen of and make your business home, both continued long after the murder of Sergei Magnitsky and many other outrages, to continue to treat Russia like a normal country. So when something happens involving Argentina or Thailand, or, there's a rule book, and you treat them like a normal country and you do normal things and you call their ambassador and so on, even after there was copious evidence that this was not a normal country. These two places that you're intimately familiar with, the places where you had been ringing the alarm bell and saying, look at this stuff, continued to treat them like a normal country. How do you explain that to yourself? Is it all about the money for empty luxury apartments on Central Park West and in Kensington High Street, the Lamborghini dealers, and the various web of interests that are very happy with the Russian money that flows into Western coffers?
Yeah, it's horrifying. So, I mean, everybody is upset now, and justifiably upset for what Putin is doing in Ukraine, but this is not the first time he's done anything terrible. I mean, Putin, he invaded Georgia in 2008. He took Crimea in 2014, shot down MH17. He carpet bombed Aleppo. He poisoned people in Salisbury, England, using banned chemical nerve agents. And after every single one of these things, we could have come down hard on Putin, and we didn't. And we didn't because there were so many vested interests here and in London, where I live, in Germany, in France. There were so many people feeding at the trough that were basically getting money. And I'm not just talking about Lamborghini. In Britain, they have two chambers of parliament, the House of Commons and the House of Lords. There's a guy named Lord Barker, Lord Gregory Barker, and he was working for Oleg Deripaska. While he was in the House of Lords, Oleg Deripaska is a Russian oligarch. He was placed on the US sanctions list. And then this guy, Lord Barker, travels to the United States with his Lord business card, goes to Congress, goes to the Treasury Department, and gets some of Deripaska's companies off of the sanctions list, and gets a $5 million bonus. Lord Barker, at the upper lawmaking body, it's unbelievable. We have another Lord, Lord Lebedev of Siberia, and I'm not joking. He's called Lord Lebedev of Siberia. He was He's a member of the House of Lords. He's a Russian guy, became a British citizen, bought up one of the major newspapers. His dad was a KGB agent, and he became a member of the House of Lords. Dana Rohrabacher, the guy I was telling you about, a representative Republican from Orange County, he was running all the Russian traps all through Congress. I mean, we have all these people running around doing this stuff for the money.
Be thinking of your brilliant, elegant, and brief questions. We'll be coming to you soon. Let's talk a little bit about the Republican Party in this modern era. I'm a Cold War kid. In the early 60s, several times a year, I would hide under my desk in PS 128, because when the big one fell on Wall Street, my desk was going to save me from nuclear winter. Luckily, it never came to that, but nobody took a second spot to Republicans in Washington in their fierce denunciation of the USSR, of their identification of Russia as one of the sources of all the mischief in the world, and as a malign force in the world community. Fast forward half a century, and here we are with some of the biggest apologists for the Russian state in official circles, members of the Republican Party. What's that all about?
Well, I think that, first of all, I think we have to be careful, because I spent a lot of time in Washington. And
not all, yes. Okay. Let me rephrase that. Many of your allies who helped get the Magnitsky Act passed were Republicans, and Republicans were in control of Congress.
And are Republicans. So, I mean, right. my biggest ally in the entire Washington establishment is Senator Roger Wicker, a Republican from Mississippi. He stands firmly every day condemning Russia for all the terrible things they do, and there's many other Republicans.
Well, he was probably hiding under a desk at PS 128 like me, and so he understands.
So the Magnitsky Act, we passed the Magnitsky Act in 2012. The Global Magnitsky Act was passed in 2016. And the Global Magnitsky Act, for some strange reason, needed to be reauthorized. And it was just recently reauthorized. And the Global Magnitsky Act is almost totally uncontroversial. Should we or should we not reauthorize a piece of legislation that bans torturers and murderers and kleptocrats from coming into the United States and using our banking system? Of course we shouldn't.
But just for a second, explain what the Global Act does that the Magnitsky Act plainly said does not. This puts other obligations on the United States that reach out into the rest of the
world.
Goes
to China, goes to Venezuela, and all this other stuff. It's a no-brainer if there ever was a no-brainer. But hold on a second. So there were 8 members of the House of Representatives that voted against it. And they were all Republicans. And those were the Republicans you're talking about. And by the way, one of them is from the 3rd District of here in Colorado. Lauren Boebert,
we didn't want to get into local politics in this. It's a national affairs thing. But
then there's Marjorie Taylor Greene and Madison Cawthorn, and so there are some crazies in the Republican Party, and there are some really horrible people that were in Donald Trump's circle that had this bad view of Russia. But I think it would be wrong to malign the entire Republican establishment.
It's
because there really is no daylight between Democrats and Republicans when it comes to Ukraine, when it comes to almost all this stuff, other than these crazies, these 8 individuals. I hope they all get voted out of office next round.
But the President of the United States, when one interviewer noted that Vladimir Putin was a killer, didn't say, well, yeah, unfortunately, yeah, but I got to do business with him. He said, what, do you think we don't have killers? He did a moral equivalency with the Russian state, an American leader. There are endless numbers of examples of things like this. Big NRA delegation. went to Russia with Maria Butina. Russia does not have open carry laws. If you haven't been there, I don't want to rock your world, but if you're an NRA member, don't expect some sort of carte blanche in Russia for carrying your weapon. There were all these sort of odd connections. There's Maria Butina in a picture with Rick Santorum with their arms around each other, with various Republicans on Capitol Hill. There was just this weird about face from clenched jawed Cold War anger to this new thing where some of the more nationalist elements of the Republican Party held up Russia as an exemplar of defending the values of Christian civilization. This is not an odd, one-off, hardly ever happens thing, but a pretty consistent strain in one part of American politics.
Yeah, well, it's so I should point out that the Russians are equal opportunity corruptors, and they did that in this weird sort of crazy far-right part of the Republican Party. They also did it in the far-left part of the British Labour Party. Jeremy Corbyn and all of his guys were all fully on board with all this nastiness. And so, you know, basically the Russians, they just poke around and look for every opportunity for where they can find useful idiots or corrupt people, and those who sign up, those people often end up having terrible things happen to them when they become less useful idiots.
Where are my mic people? There is one mic person. There is another mic person. Neither of them, incidentally, named Mike. And the questioners, who has a great question to get us started? See, some people hesitated. They thought, oh, I got a question, but it's not necessarily great. Here.
Hi, thanks first for your books and for your advocacy. I appreciate it. But Putin's going to die someday, and I think sooner rather than later, based on his bloated, steroidal face. And what do you think the next step is, or what happens?
Well, so first of all, I think that we need to, it feels like, you know, that's the easy way out. He dies and everything gets, you know. So first of all, I don't think, if you were to go into Google, you can do this right now, search Putin cancer, the first articles start coming up in 2013 in the Daily Mail. I mean, people have been hoping, and there's been all sorts of experts saying with great confidence that he's going to die soon. And so I wouldn't sort of hold out hope that that's going to be the solution to this problem. And the second thing is, if he were to die, it all depends on how he dies, what happens. So I think the best comparable of what's most likely to happen is there was a really brutal dictator in the country of Uzbekistan, which is neighbors Russia. And this guy made Putin look like a vegetarian. He would boil his political opponents alive in vats of oil and other really horrible stuff. And his name is Karimov. And one day he died in his sleep at the ripe age of 80 something of a stroke. And then everyone was saying, okay, what's gonna happen next? You know, is Uzbekistan gonna now become a normal country? And all the powers that be went into some building in Tashkent, and some black smoke came out of the chimney. And then the head of the KGB became the new president of Uzbekistan. And for like a couple of weeks, a few human rights organizations talked about the reform of Uzbekistan. This guy's now a reformer because he doesn't boil his political opponents alive. And it turns out nothing of the sort. I think most likely, if Putin were to die today in his sleep or of cancer or whatever, then that's the way it would go. There's some scenario where, and this is the one Putin's most afraid of, which is I can imagine that if the Ukrainians were to beat the Russians back from their borders, and the Russians can tolerate a lot of things. They can tolerate terrible atrocities committed in their name, babies being killed and women being raped, but they absolutely cannot tolerate a loser running their country. They hate that. They hate a weak loser. And so if Putin were seen to be a loser, then they might hang him from a lamppost if they were driven out of Ukraine. And in that case, then maybe Alexei Navalny becomes the next leader of Russia.
Can we get a mic down here?
Hard to get these mics around.
You had to sit in one of the most difficult places in the room to get a mic to you.
I'm a difficult person. I'd be interested in your sense of whether or not, particularly in oil and gas, whether or not sanctions, Western sanctions, are truly having a negative impact on both the Russian economy and on Putin.
So this is the, whatever, $300 billion question. And this is the crucial issue. So we've frozen Putin's savings. We got his half of his central bank reserves, and we're going after the oligarch money offshore. But every day, Russia receives $1 billion a day from the sale of oil and gas. And that's every day he spends $1 billion killing Ukrainians. And so that's kind of, he could run this horrible, murderous war into perpetuity if we continue to do that. And so there's two things going on. One is that the Europeans have agreed to stop buying Russian oil by the end of the year, and that's 200 million of the $1 billion a day, but there's still 800 million of gas. Now there's a couple of interesting things. The first is that the Russians are kind of doing our job for us. So to convince the Germans and the Italians and other people to like turn your thermostats down and like freeze this winter is not going to be an easy thing to do, and I think to some extent the Germans have the willpower to do some of that, but the Russians are doing it for us. So the Russians have cut off the gas to Bulgaria, to Poland, to Lithuania, and just yesterday they turned off the gas to Germany. For the German thing, it's only a 10-day thing, but I think they're just doing it to show the Germans that it's possible. But it may be that the Russians do this own their own sort of self-sacrifice, in which case the money dries up. I mean, if they don't sell gas, the money dries up. I don't think that Europe will stop buying Russian gas in its entirety. But there's one other thing which nobody talks about, and this is something that, you know, a seed to plant in your brain to think about things in the future, which is that in order to run oil companies and the gas company, you need technology. You need and the Russians, you need oil service companies, to Schlumberger, Halliburton. And there's an interesting comparable or parallel that happened, which is when Venezuela kicked out all the Western oil companies, they also no longer had the Western oil service companies. And Venezuela is considered to be one of the largest oil reserve countries in the world, but it's now one of the poorest countries in the world because they couldn't get any oil pumped out of the ground. And we're already starting to see that the Russian oil production is suffering from the lack of oil service technology. And I think that they're going to have a, I think that you're going to see a very precipitous decline in Russian oil production, which will mean less money for them to be made. It's never going to go to zero, but it doesn't have to go to zero. All it has to do is get impacted by a certain amount, and that will have a big impact. The other interesting thing and the other important thing is, what is the oil price? Because Russia is actually making more money now than they've ever made before, because oil prices are, well, they were 2 weeks ago higher than they've ever been, or higher than they've been recently. but it looks like with oil prices that high, people stop driving in the United States, and people start pumping oil in other parts of the world. And so I think that oil prices will probably go down and go down further. And so I think that Russia is in for a hard economic time ahead, even if we don't do the sanctions, because of the all these other factors going into play. And so I think it's, Putin is probably sitting in his best place right now, and it's just going to get worse from here.
If you go to war to stop NATO expansion and you're funding a war by selling oil and encouraging your customers to do without you, aren't you not achieving your war aims? Like, what? There may be like 125 members of NATO before this war is over. It doesn't seem like Vladimir Putin is winning that part of the argument.
Well, so if you assume that he's done this war for NATO or for stop NATO expansion, that's true. But I don't believe he's done this war to stop NATO expansion. I believe that this war is all about kleptocracy. Putin has stolen $1 trillion. Putin and 1,000 people around him have stolen $1 trillion from the Russian state in the last 22 years. And I think that after a while, that they're scared that the Russian people were going to lynch them And it happened, by the way, in Kazakhstan earlier this year in January, that their dictator got taken out because they raised the price of liquid petroleum gas by 50%. And the people of Kazakhstan set the whole country on fire and presidential palace and so on until the dictator was removed. I think that's what Putin was afraid of. And so I think this is a war of distraction. I think that Putin just dug into the dictator's playbook because he was scared of all the Russian people coming after him. And what does a dictator do when you're scared of your people? You start a war, create a foreign enemy. And if that's the case, then Putin's end game, Putin is actually pretty happy with the end game because being at war is what he wants. And if that's the case, there's no amount of NATO promises or NATO expansion promises that we could ever make to him to stop this war in Ukraine.
In the back, yeah.
What can an everyday person do to shift the balance to the side of the good guys? Who to call, who to give money to, who to go to the front lines and fight for?
So just for everyone's edification, this is Bill Alpert from Barron's. He's a hero in my book. And so you should read Barron's every Saturday. Well, I think the first thing that everyone should do is turn down depends what season you're in, but don't use so much air conditioning in the summer, and don't use so much heating in the winter, and don't drive as much, and demand of your representatives not to, if you live in the 3rd District of Colorado, vote for Adam Frisch. We cannot let the continuation of this war. We cannot become inured to the continuation of this war. This is what happens all the time. Where after it's been in the news for a while, people just stop paying attention. And I was just in Davos at the World Economic Forum, and I can remember like 5 or 6 years ago, everyone was talking about Afghanistan, and I didn't hear the word Afghanistan mentioned once. And Assad killed 500,000 people and created millions of refugees, and he's kind of been let off the hook. We absolutely cannot let Putin off the hook, and we have to continue to support the Ukrainians long after it's interesting to do so.
Yes, over there on the side.
Thank you very much. I forget the woman's name, but she runs the central bank in Russia and is very close to Putin. I've been reading about her. I forget her name. How is she managing to keep the economic status of Russia afloat and doing such a good balancing act, it looks like?
So her name is Elvira Nabiulina. And I wouldn't say she's doing a good job. So what the Russians have done is they've told every citizen, it doesn't matter how much money you have in your bank account, you can no longer withdraw it. You can't convert any rubles to dollars. You can no longer buy any foreign goods. And so guess what? $1 billion a day comes in to buy Russian oil and gas, and no money is going out to buy Kellogg's cornflakes. And as a result, the currency is artificially stabilized. But if you asked any Russian, would you like to convert all your rubles to dollars and leave the country, they'd probably say yes, but they can't, they're not allowed to do that. And so it's a mirage. I don't think the Russian currency is the exchange rate is a real exchange rate. And the economy is not doing well at all. The economy is in an absolute mess. I think that when it's all fully kind of digested, I mean, there like 1,000 foreign companies have pulled out. You can't. There's no more iPhones. There's no more Netflix. You can't use your MasterCard. You can't travel. The only two countries you can travel to, foreign countries you can travel to, are Turkey and Dubai. The planes are all grounded for the most part because they can't get American parts. The whole thing is a complete, absolute economic mess. And you'll see this starting to come through in the statistics, assuming that they ever allow the real ones to be reported. And so I don't think there's no miracle or or levitation that they're doing. This is all, it's really not a good situation.
But could this cause a simple reorientation of the Russian economy toward the East, to the places that don't really care that much about transparency, annual reports that contain real figures, that kind of stuff?
Well, everybody thought that China was going to be the savior of Russia. And it's interesting because after MasterCard stopped doing their thing, everyone thought they would use Alipay. But Alipay doesn't want to stop doing business in Russia as well because they don't want to be subject to secondary sanctions or subject to consumer boycotts. And everyone thought that the Chinese mobile phone companies would be all pervasive. That hasn't happened. And so I don't think China has turned out to be this savior for the Russians. I don't think there is any savior. It's not like the Russians, everyone says, well, the Russian oligarchs can't go to Saint-Tropez. Well, they'll go to other places. Where are they going to go? Are they going to go on vacation to China? In Saudi Arabia? I don't think so. And so are they going to keep their money in Dubai banks? Some sheikh in Dubai say, actually, that's not your money, that's mine now. What are they going to do? That's why they like to keep their money in rule of law countries, and that's why these sanctions are so powerful, because all these people, these people kill for money, and there's nothing more important to them than their money, and now their money is getting frozen around the world, and that's really very, very strong.
Do you have time for one more? Sure.
In case you didn't hear that, is there a way of getting the money, all the frozen money, to Ukraine? Excellent question and really important thought, which is that at the moment, the estimate of the damage that Russia has done to Ukraine, physical damage, is $1 trillion. That's what it's going to cost to rebuild Ukraine. And it's going to have to come from somewhere. And we've frozen $350 billion of Russian central bank reserves. And that's the first place it should come from. The Canadians were the first ones onto this. They have a thing called the Frozen Asset Repurposing Act, which was passed by their parliament. And the United States is working on something similar. The UK is working on something similar. And I think that this is going to become an important part of the whole exercise. I think it's really easy to do it to the central bank reserves. I think it's more complicated when it comes to oligarch money, because those oligarchs are going to hire the best lawyers in the world and tie up government investigators, government prosecutors for years. But we can at least start with that $350 billion and then work our way down to the oligarchs.
Please thank Bill Browder. The book is called Freezing Order, A True Story of Money Laundering, Murder, and Surviving Vladimir Putin's Wrath. It's for sale in the lobby, Bitcoin, rubles, or US dollars. If you enjoyed the conversation, it can be heard on a podcast called World Affairs, which is my podcast, and on KQED FM in San Francisco, where this will become one-hour radio show next Monday night, so you can listen again. Take care.
Great conversation.